Hello everybody, my name is Walter and this is episode 15 of my Redstone component series. In this episode I will talk about the Redstone block and the TNT block. I will start with the general information about those blocks, then I will go in detail of how they work, and then I will give you finally a few examples of what they are usually used for. So first things first, how can you get those blocks? Let's start with the Redstone block. The Redstone block is crafted out of 9 Redstone dust in a 3x3 grid. And this crafting recipe is reversible, so you can also break a redstone block down into 9 redstone dust, which makes this a very compact way to store redstone dust. TNT you can actually find lying around in the world as naturally generated traps in desert temples and woodland mansions. It also gets dropped when you break a TNT minecart, and you can also find it in chests within shipwrecks and buried treasures. And of course you can craft it. The crafting recipe you can see here, so an X shape of 5 gunpowder and then around that 4 sand. This can be the normal sand or it can also be red sand, and you can even mix that up. Doesn't really matter there. Fun fact here, this crafting recipe is actually a mixture of 3 real life explosives. Gunpowder itself is an explosive. Then the mixture here is reminding of dynamite, which is basically nitroglycerin in, yeah, somewhat sand. And then we have TNT, which is actually short for trinitrotoluene. So the crafting recipe in Minecraft is basically a mixture of those three. Next, let's talk about the blocks themselves. They are both very similar actually, so both are transparent blocks, so this means they won't transmit any redstone power, although the redstone block obviously emits redstone power. They are both movable blocks, they don't emit any light, and they don't let any light through. Where they mostly deviate is in the mining. To mine a redstone block you need a pickaxe, to mine a TNT block you don't need any tools, and it is also instantly. And with that we get to the functionality. So the redstone block is basically a weak redstone power source with a signal strength of 15. So on all neighboring blocks it produces a weak redstone power. So it can power redstone wire and also other redstone components, but it can't power blocks. As you can see, this redstone dot up there is not powered actually. There was actually a snapshot where the redstone block produced strong power, but that was very quickly changed back into weak power. And with that we get to the TNT block, which as you can see here is a bit more interesting. So let's start at the top here. When you want to trigger a TNT, you can do this with redstone power as you can see here, and after it has been triggered, it waits for 4 seconds until it explodes. Possible triggers are redstone power, as you have seen here, clicking on it with a flint and steel, fire, although there is a random amount of time before the fire actually triggers the TNT, but after that it is 4 seconds until the explosion comes around, clicking on it with a fire charge, hitting it with a flaming arrow, either through an enchantment or maybe a lava curtain. The wither projectile is explosive, so it will also trigger it, and basically all explosions will trigger the TNT block. And when it is triggered by an explosion, the trigger time is not 4 seconds, but instead it is a random amount of time between a half second and 1.5 seconds. So this is a randomized explosion then, so this makes it a bit unpredictable. Explosions destroy blocks around them unless the TNT explodes in water. If it explodes in water, as you can see, it does not produce any destroyed blocks around it, and it won't also trigger TNT around it, since the TNT is only triggered if it is actually destroyed by the explosion, basically. What still happens is that entities around it are damaged and also knocked back. This obviously happens also if the TNT is not exploding in water. How far the explosion can penetrate into blocks depends on the blast resistance of those blocks, and how much damage an entity gets is depending on the distance between the explosion and the entity. And also the type of explosion, but for TNT it's always the same type. When a block is destroyed by TNT, it is always dropped as an item if you are in the Java edition 1.14 or higher. Before that, there was only a certain chance that it would be dropped. And also one special thing. Let's put an item in there and an item out here. And now let's explode this. And as you can see here, if there is anything between the explosion and a dropped item, the dropped item will survive. If it has a direct line of sight between the explosion and the dropped item, it will be destroyed, independent whether it's in water or outside of water. Furthermore, when you trigger a TNT block, it turns from a block into an entity. The entity is no longer one block side length. Instead, it is now just 0.98 meters in side length, so a tiny bit smaller, and it also gets a random velocity. This has an upwards component and a randomized sideways component in any direction. As you can see here, it jumps up a bit and towards one side once I trigger it. This is completely randomized and also not predictable. Furthermore, when you are using a dispenser, instead of dispensing a block or an item, you're dispensing a primed TNT. Another thing to know is that if you want to have a explosion underwater that actually destroys blocks around it, all you need to do is place the TNT, then place a sand block on top of it, and then prime the TNT. Because the TNT turns into an entity, falls down, the sand now falls also down into the same space, removes the water in that space, and then the TNT explosion can work its magic. For the dispenser, the prime TNT will explode after 4 seconds, obviously. Now there are two more things that you should know when you are working with TNT and commands. And that is, first of all, when you are looking with the F3 menu, you will see here a block data called unstable. So what is that unstable block data? Basically, unstable means that, let's actually summon in one that is unstable. As you can see now, unstable is true. And the difference between the true and the false is, if I left click on the false, it drops as an item. If I left click on the true, it actually gets primed. So that's one way to make sure that no one can actually remove that TNT without triggering it. And furthermore, there is an NBT data to the primed TNT called fuse, and that is actually the time between triggering and the actual explosion. So this is basically the countdown. This can be set to any amount of time between 0 and a bit more than 27 minutes. Here, for an example, half a second or 10 game ticks. What is important to know here is that the default is 0. If you just summon a TNT block into the world and you don't give it a specified fuse number or time, it will immediately explode. So this is one thing to be aware of. And with that, let's actually talk a bit more about the blast resistance. For that, I prepared a little something here where I can summon in shapes of blocks of various sizes with different blast resistances. And then once I have done that, I summon in the center of that a prime TNT. Let's start with slime blocks, which have no blast resistance at all. And as you can see, it destroys quite a lot of this area here. What is interesting here is that the blast resistance of 0 also is an attribute of currently moving blocks. This is something that is used, for example, by Imango in his blast jammers quite a lot, to remove blocks quite efficiently with very little TNT needed. Now if we go just one half up to ice, as you can see, the explosion now has quite a bit of less effect than before. What you also can see here is that glass is one of the few blocks that actually don't drop as an item when exploded. Then we have stone, which has a blast resistance of 6. And here you get basically a 3x3x3 cube. Depending on some random factors, one or maybe up to 3 or 4 of those corners here may remain. If we go up to 9 end stone, we actually get a similar explosion, but now all of those corners here will remain. And then basically everything above that is complete blast resistance, so next step would be 600 of the ender chest, and then it goes up to obsidian, obviously, then obsidian 1200, bedrock 3.6 million, so obviously it won't actually get destroyed. Water is actually between ender chests and endstone, but 100 is already at a point where it won't actually get destroyed. But what I want to show you here is the underwater TNT. So I have TNT with some sand falling on top of it, and as you can see, it is actually capable of destroying the blocks below it. So let's quickly do it without the sand. Let's remove the sand. And as you can see, now this prismarine floor here is not damaged at all. If I summon it in with the sand here, you can see the prismarine floor gets destroyed. Prismarine, by the way, same blast resistance as stone. And that's those blast resistance examples done. By the way, if you are interested in how those explosions actually work and are calculated in Minecraft, I will put a link in the description of this video for the corresponding Wikipedia article, where it is actually explained quite in detail of how that works. And I almost forgot to talk about the bot and observer interaction with those two blocks. Here all I have to say is that this is pretty much irrelevant for those two blocks because they are very static. The redstone block doesn't really change at all, and the TNT block turns into an entity, so this is the same as if you were removing the block manually. So besides of the interaction any normal block has with buds and observers, there is nothing special going on here. And with that, we finally get to the examples. But before that, one little mentioning of this command block here. If you download this build and for some reason accidentally trigger any of those TNT here, don't worry, just quickly stand on this pressure plate here and the command block here will destroy or remove all primed TNT around it, before you will have to reload this entire world here. Anyway, let's continue with the examples. So the first example I want to talk about is the one tick torch. Simply place down a redstone block and then a torch on top or on the side of it. And what you get out of the torch is a one redstone tick long pulse. Although nowadays I actually prefer using observers for that, because then you can just put a lever on the observer side and then just trigger it by activating the lever. Another common use for, or most common use for redstone blocks is obviously as a movable power source. So here we have the example of an instant repeater, and basically it uses this redstone block here to power this redstone wire at the end, and also a bit of the circuitry necessary for the instant repeater here. Now having said that, there are usually cheaper alternatives, for example simply moving a full block with a torch below it or maybe a repeater running into it, which would have a similar effect. Although it is cheaper, it is also a bit bigger and sometimes you don't have the space for this to work otherwise. For example, here you wouldn't be able to do it in that way. Next up we have one of the first flying machines, so just normal piston, sticky piston, normal piston, and then two slime blocks and two redstone blocks, and this was more or less the first one-way flying machine in the game and wasn't possible with or wouldn't be possible without those redstone blocks here. And since those early days used the combination of redstone blocks and slime blocks, this kind of construct was also known as slimestone. Another use for that is actually not in a linear fashion, but in a circular fashion. So here we have a Wankel engine, a redstone Wankel engine, which is basically a rotating power source. I have very fond memories of this because this was what I represented in my first subscriber special actually. And with that, let's get to the examples for the TNT use. Let's start with one of the most famous ones, which is the TNT cannon. All you need to do is summon in some TNT here, then a bit later there. This explodes, jettisons this TNT, and then at some point it explodes back there. How far it travels is randomized due to the fact that TNT, when it is summoned, has a somewhat randomized starting velocity, and thus the whole setup is never really the same between triggering. There is of course a certain minimum distance and a certain maximum distance, but between in them you can't really tell where the whole thing will land on. But let's continue on. TNT can also be used to fight. One example would be so-called spleef arenas. So TNT, as mentioned before, can be insta-mined, meaning if you have a floor out of TNT, invite a friend or a few, and then you simply click on the blocks below them and try to drop them to the floor below without getting dropped yourself, and then the last one standing has won, of course. Another one is a bit more violent, simply paste on the TNT, triggered with a flint and steel for example, and then get out of dodge. This can be used to damage mobs, of course, if you are fighting against a mob of mobs, or if you are fighting against other players. Another other common use are in traps and self-destruct systems. So traps, as mentioned before, can also be found naturally generated, but you can also build them. Here just two very simple examples, the trapped chest, just replace the glass block down here with a full block, and once you open this chest, the TNT below it will explode, or at least get triggered and then explode. Or the same would be the landmine, just a pressure plate here. Once more, replace the glass with a full block, and if you stand on top of it, the TNT below it will be triggered. The bond villain bases or self-destructs for bases are another example. Load-bearing bosses are bosses or objects that, when destroyed or removed, will once more trigger TNT. A rather interesting use for TNT are in TNT missiles and torpedoes if you are underwater. And those are basically flying machines that contain TNT, like this one here, which was, by the way, designed by Robert Huber. And is in the moment not armed. To arm it, you just need to replace this glass block here with another TNT. And if you trigger the entire system, it will start to run into this direction here until it hits an obstacle. And if it does that, it will stop, trigger one of those TNT here, and then of course will trigger an explosion. Let's show you this in action. So I have the target there, and to start it I have to update this piston down here, and I'm doing this with this node block here. And as you can see, this is a rather fast missile actually. And as you can see, it has now been stopped. This TNT gets triggered and triggers the rest of the setup. So just one example. There are very different ways to create those. As I mentioned, torpedoes can be underwater. You can have them supercharged, which this design is actually, so a very fast flying machine. They can be so-called bunker busters or penetrators, which are able to actually get through a thick wall before they explode, or at least they have a certain part that gets into the wall before a part further at the back actually triggers. So they are able to not only scratch at the surface of the world, but actually destroy quite a bit of it. Then you have also setups that have a timing mechanism inside of it, or more or less a counting mechanism, which counts the steps it has done, and after a certain amount of steps, it, for example, triggers the TNT, or similar things. So there's a multitude of possibilities right there. And the last example for heute sind so-called TNT dupers. Using certain glitches, you can actually have a TNT which is in a budded state. And if you move this entire setup here, you can see that it creates a duplicate which is actually a primed TNT, which gets pushed forward. This can be used in a multitude of ways, for example, to create an automatic mining system, or to create an automatic tunnel bore, or to have a blast chamber where you don't have to refill the dispenser at any given point. And with that, we have finally reached the end of this episode about the redstone block and the TNT block. I hope I was able to explain to you how those blocks work and how they are used. I also hope you enjoyed this little episode, and well, see ya!